Good morning. Welcome to worship at First Baptist Church. We're glad you're here. There's a beautiful picture of what heaven's going to be like in Revelation. And John gives us this vision of what's going on down there, up there. And it talks about winged creatures and angels that surround the throne. And all day long, continuously, they're repeating, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." And they repeat that over and over and over. That's a picture of their worship. Today, we're going to praise the Lord for who he is. We're going to sing that very same thing. "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." Let's stand together as we sing.
Standing in his presence. We indeed are standing in holy ground. As we meet here, we have the promise that the Lord meets with us. And as we've been talking about, reading about worship over the last few weeks, as we come here together, we must look up to Him. We exalt His name, for the Lord is the only one worthy of our praise. And to do that, we have to get rid of the I. And as we've talked about this past week, we focus on the we as we are here, that we love one another. And that love for one another and love for the Lord leads us to motivates us to worship Him. So pray that as we come, that true worship will take place here today as we consider the holiness of our God. Let's pray together with that in mind and consider the fact that you and I get to approach through prayer the holy throne of God. Let's pray together. Father, we come before you, joining with the angels, to declare that indeed you are holy. As you sit on your throne with the whole world in your hands, the heavens declare your holiness. And Father, we want to come alongside them today and declare that in this place. We're thankful that you desire to meet with us, to inhabit the praises of your people. And I pray that that will happen here, Father, as we take the focus off of ourselves and we focus on giving you the worship that you desire and that you are worthy of. Lord, help us to be still in your presence and to know that you are God, to know that you're in control, know that you reign. Lord, would you take every anxiety, every concern, everything that competes for our attention, would you take those away from us today and let us focus on you and you alone. So we commit this time to you. We want to use it to exalt your name. We want to use it to allow you to speak to us and to change our life so that we can be more like you. Use this time, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
God has been speaking since the beginning of time. It says that God spoke the world into being, and He still speaks today. A lot of people say it's hard to hear from God. God's always speaking through His Word, and we have those words have been passed down from generation to generation, and they're still the same today because it is living, it's active with the breath of God. Let's stand together as we sing about those ancient words. Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Words of life, words of hope, give us strength, help us cope in this world. Ancient words will guide us home. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Holy words of our faith, sacrifice. Oh, heed the faithful words of Christ. Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh,
Let us come with an open heart to the ancient words of Jesus found in John chapter 10. As today we wrap up today launches the wrap up of our 40 days of focus. As we started five weeks ago, if you remember, I brought the junk drawer from my house and talked about we had to eliminate the junk in our life to focus on God, and that we are to worship Him with everything of all of our being, everything that we have, every part of us. And I didn't think about, as we focused on worship, didn't realize just really how much junk we had in the drawer of our life. For over the last few weeks, as we have journeyed through talking in Sunday school and talking to individuals, the things they've read and how God has worked with them, I must tell you, there's a whole lot of I in our worship. There's a whole lot of I in our junk drawer. That you and I come with our preferences, our wants, our wishes, the things that we think worship ought to look like. And as we talked about this past week, read about, talked in Sunday school just a little bit ago, how as we come together as one and worship together, we worship with a love for one another. So we talked about worship with all that we have and how that worship leads us to praise, to lifting God, and that we draw near to Him, we know Him, get to know Him in a deeper way that leads to us having an impactful time of worship together. And as we come to worship, we desire to hear from God. The issue is, we're not going to hear from God if we're not loving Him with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. We're not going to hear from God if we're not praising Him. We're not going to hear from God if we're not drawing closer to Him and getting to know Him more. We're not going to hear from God if we're not worshiping together or if there's a lot of I in our worship. So I want us to come knowing that today to this last part, the last Sunday also before we begin our revival services. And let's eliminate the I, for we're told that we have to humble ourselves if revival is ever going to come. As we eliminate the I from our life, we desire to hear from God. There's probably all of us that want to hear from God. That's why we're here today. Yes, we want to praise Him, but we also want to hear from Him. Or do we? Let's notice what Jesus says in John chapter 10, beginning in verse 1. Very truly I tell you, Pharisees, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all of his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but the Pharisees did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, in verse 7, Jesus said again, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to kill and steal and destroy. I have come so that they may have life and have it to the full. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. Verse 14, I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father. And I have laid down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of the sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father." Every lady in here would testify that when you send a man to the store, you should give very specific instructions. I want you to think about this. Guys, they give us a list. their list, and it tells us what to get. They can put generic things like toothpaste, okay? And so you and I take and we head off toward the toothpaste aisle, and we get there and we hang the right onto that aisle, and it's as long as from here to Main Street. Full of toothpaste on both sides, top to bottom. And so let's say you and I were there and we're standing there. We don't know what toothpaste to get. We hadn't paid that much attention. For a lady, she knows exactly what kind. But let's just say that you and I realize, okay, we use Crest. And so we narrow it down, we find the Crest section. And do you know that in some supermarkets there are 27 different varieties of Crest? And there we stand. And we finally make that selection. And say the next thing on the list is orange juice or milk. That's real simple, isn't it, ladies? Not for us. We get over there and there are all kinds of varieties of milk and of orange juice. This is one thing of orange juice you can get anywhere from an 8-ounce container to 128-ounce container. You didn't tell us what size. You just told us orange juice, milk. Don't get me started on the cereal aisle. Shampoo, same way. There's all these choices that are there. And those choices are there in our spiritual lives as well, aren't they? You and I stand today, there are a plethora of choices for us. There was choices you had probably to make to be here today. Something else competed for your time. As you sit here, something else is competing for your attention. There are things that you may have opportunities before you. And there are all these choices, all these things that are there. What are we going to do? How do we make that choice? Which do we know? How do we know which one is best, or what God wants from us, or what is His will? We say we would love for God just to speak to us in a loud, audible voice and tell us exactly what He wants. Or we want Him to write it in the sky. We wish He would communicate with us that way. Which, by the way, every time in Scripture someone heard the visible or the audible voice of God, it wasn't a very good time for them. They didn't leave feeling very good about themselves that time. So how does God speak to us? Well, Scripture teaches there's four ways, and you'll read about those this week in our journal, that God speaks to His children, but you and I must know how to listen. First of all, He speaks to us through His Word. As we study and meditate upon God's Word, we can listen for what God has to say to us. I hear people say, I want to hear God speak out loud. Have you considered reading the Bible out loud? Those are the words of God. If you read God's word out loud, you are hearing the audible word of God. God speaks to us through His word. We had to open it up. We had to read it. We had to study. We had to meditate. Think on those things. And God will never contradict His word. You know, there are certain things that you don't really have to consider. It's God telling me to do something. If it's sin, then God is going to speak against that. His word is the standard. No matter what other means He may communicate, Scripture is the final authority of what God has to say to us. So if we want to hear from Him, read His word. He speaks to us through His word. He also speaks to us through other saints, through other individuals. That He will use godly men and women to counsel us about life. Now, I think we have to be real careful there. Because who we may consider godly, God may not consider godly. What we may consider godly counsel may not be godly counsel. I think so often we run to somebody else, want them to speak to us, and we don't stop to consider what God's word might have to say. If someone gives you counsel that's opposite of God's word, then it's pretty clear that's not godly counsel. I have found that those who are usually the most eager to give counsel to us are those that are the least godly. For those who would give the most godly counsel aren't the ones standing on the street corner begging for you to listen to them, aren't the ones always there trying to give you advice, but are the ones that when you go to them in humility share with you godly counsel. So then we have to be real careful with that. And we have to probably, you look in your life, you probably have a godly grandparent or godly parent that would speak God's counsel to you. And I think we have to be even real careful with that. because they have a perspective where they want something particular for you. And their counsel may not be exactly what God would say. So again, I think we had to be very careful of saying that God's going to speak through every counsel that we may receive from someone else. But he also speaks to us through the situations of life. That God will place us in circumstances and in situations to get our attention and to speak to us and help us to realize that, hey, I shouldn't be here. Or the road I'm going down is not the best road for me. There are many different ways that God will speak to us through our circumstances of life. And then he speaks to us through the Holy Spirit. Those are those promptings we get from God. Another word would be conviction. We know when God kind of thumps us on the head, kicks us in the seat of the pants, convicts us, but also leads us. That's the still small voice of God, the quiet voice of God, that the promptings that he gives us. And again, none of those promptings are ever going to be contrary to his word. So God speaks to us through his word, through individuals, through circumstances, and through his Holy Spirit. Those are the four ways in which God speaks to his children. And the fact that God didn't create us and then leave us to figure it all out, but he gave us ways that he speaks to us, is a reminder of his grace for us. He didn't just go, well, you know what, you guys figure it out. But he gave us his word as the standard for truth and the standard, the map for which we can live our life. And he gave us people that will speak truth into us, that he leads us and lets us go into situations to speak to us and remind us of our need for him. That he gave us the Holy Spirit that comes in our life the minute that we surrender our life to the Lord, and that prompts us and leads us and guides us. So he speaks to us those four ways. Now we could wrap it up right then, right now, and say, okay, that's how God speaks. But the question is, does God speak to you? Has God spoken to you? Do you open your word and God speak to you? Do you find yourself just doing life and the promptings from the Holy Spirit leading you? See, there are some requirements that have to be in our life for us to hear from God. If he's not going to give just the audible voice, he's going to speak to us through these four ways, what must happen in our life? Well, Jesus speaks about this using the analogy of him being the good shepherd and us being the sheep. And I want us to look at these three requirements this morning. Knowing that God speaks to us, what's required? Well, first of all, you must be saved if you want to hear from God. The sheep know the voice of the shepherd. For us to hear the voice of the Lord and to listen to what he has to say, we must be his sheep. We must be saved. We must be a child of God. Contrary to popular belief today, there's only one way for an individual to be saved, and that's to believe in, trust in, and confess Jesus as your Savior and Lord. And Jesus says in verse 9, I am the gate. Some translations say, I am the door. Whoever enters through me will be saved. You can underline that word will there. It's not a might be, could be, should be. It's a will be saved. Jesus is the entryway to eternal life. Many people today would tell you there are many doors, there are many different ways, and all you have to do is pick one. Some would tell you they all lead to the same place. But Jesus made the claim that he was the exclusive way to God in John 14:6. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. We must come to him who began his ministry at the Sermon on the Mount by telling us that broad is the gate, wide is the road that leads to destruction, and many find it. But narrow is the gate, and small is the road that leads to life, and few find it. That we must come to the Lord and realize that he is the only way to the Father, and we must confess him as the Savior and the Lord of our life. And until we do that, we will never hear from God. Jesus goes on and describes himself in verse 14 as the good shepherd. And he says, I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father. I want you to understand here that the good shepherd knows his sheep in the same way that the Father knows the Son. And not only that, but the sheep know the shepherd in the same way that the Son knows the Father. Now let's try to wrap our heads around that Jesus, his relationship with God, characterizes the intimacy that he desires with his followers. Just as he and the Father share a profound love, so too Jesus and his flock share the same quality of love. To try to wrap your mind around it today, that Jesus desires to have a relationship with you as close as he has to the Father. It's mind-blowing that he would want to know you and he would want to know me in our sinful condition in the same way that he knows his Father who is holy, and we've sang about that today. That the Lord who says, Jesus who says that he and the Father are one, he desires to have that same oneness with me and with you. It ought to blow our mind to know that he wants to know us that way. This isn't just a head knowledge, but that word know there speaks of intimacy. And that's what the Father and the Son want to have with us. Jewish shepherds kept their sheep in two kinds of sheepfolds. If they were out in the country, they would use nature to make their pens. So they would maybe get up on the side of a mountain. They would use bushes even that would have been planted to be a sheep pen. And so if you're just kind of wandering along out in the wilderness, you would find one of those when it came time to get some rest at night, and you would put your sheep in that pen. But if you were in town, there was a community corral, so to speak. It had a professional gatekeeper. So somebody was hired to take care, make sure that your sheep didn't come in and out. Nobody got those. So you would come with your sheep into town. You had business to do. You would put all of your sheep in this sheep pen along with everybody else's sheep. I don't know if you've ever noticed, but sheep look a whole lot alike. And so the question becomes, how do you know whose sheep are whose? When the shepherd comes, how does he know that these are his sheep? Well, it was easy. He would just go into the pen that was there in the corral and begin to talk to his sheep. Just walk among the sheep and talk, and his sheep would begin to separate themselves and follow him, for they knew him. They knew his voice. And even today, visitors to the Holy Lands have been known to pay a shepherd to exchange clothes with them so that they can call the sheep to try to blow this theory that Jesus is using. And every time they go out into the field and they call the sheep with the shepherd's clothes on, but the sheep do not come because they only obey the voice of their shepherd. When you have an intimate relationship with the shepherd, you hear his voice, and following him is easy because you know it's his voice speaking to you. And do you notice how he calls us? Verse 3 tells us that he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. Do you get that? That we're not called by a group and we're not given a number. It's not like we're in the large waiting room where you pull the number and wait for them to call your number. No, that's dehumanizing. There's nothing personal about that. That's very cold and indifferent. But instead, our shepherd, Jesus, calls us by name. A name is personal. A name was given to us by someone who loved us and put a lot of thought into that name. And Jesus sees us on our need to have a name, and he calls us by name, and he leads us out. See, in this context here, a sheep's primary function was to produce wool. And so you weren't raising these sheep to kill them. You were raising them up to get their wool. And so many times a sheep would be with a shepherd for a long number of years. There became a close relationship there, and it was common for shepherds to name their sheep just like you would a pet today. And oftentimes you named them based upon physical characteristics. So maybe over here you had long nose, and on this side you had black ear, and maybe you had a fluffy. I just had to think you had a fluffy. And, you know, just based upon characteristics, based upon their deposition, and that's how they were known. And the Lord uses that to show us how much he loves us. He calls us by name. And he calls us by characteristics. And we hear his voice. And those who have been saved follow him. And to know that he knows us in our most profound ways. He knows our past with all of our failures and all of our hurts. He knows where we are presently. He knows the longings that we have for the future. He knows us in the most intimate ways, and he calls us by name. I have to wonder, though, at times, that maybe he doesn't call us by some of those characteristics that we would rather not have. I wonder sometimes if he doesn't look at us and go, well, there's Ophirful over there. And there's Grumpy. And there's Fearless. And over here is Faithless. And there's Faithful. You have to wonder if he doesn't look at us sometime and call us by that. And we know who we are at that particular moment because we know that's in our life. And we know he's speaking to us. So today, if you're here and you say you cannot hear the voice of God, I challenge you to examine your heart and ask yourself if you really know Jesus as your Savior, if you truly have been saved. If not, then you can today. It's as easy as ABC. Admit to God that you're a sinner. Believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins and rose 3 days later. And then you commit to him as the Lord and the Savior of your life. It's that simple. And today, if you're sitting here and honestly going, you know what you're talking about is foreign, because I read God's word and he has spoke to me, I hadn't heard the promptings of the Spirit, none of these things have happened, I don't hear the voice of God, I want God to speak to me. Could it be that you are not saved? As we've gone through this journal and we've talked about worship, it's made me wonder how many of us that could be said of us. You know what? We may have prayed a prayer, and we may have stood in a baptism pool, and we may have done other spiritual stuff, but we are not saved. You are not a child of God. And today you understand that you need to forget about what somebody's going to think about you. You may need to forget about anything you put out ahead. And the fact of the matter is, you realize if the Lord came back at this particular moment, you would go to hell. If we haven't heard the voice of God, that's true of you today. Now, the other thing would be, there are times that we've heard the voice of God, but it's been a long time since we've heard the voice of God. I love our local radio station. They're providing a ministry for us right now as we gather, are producing our service for us, broadcasting our service for those who can't be here and are able to listen. So I like to listen to a lot of local things, whether it's a ball game or maybe a city meeting that's being broadcast. And so a lot of times I may leave here and happen to pass by City Hall, the police station, and see there's a meeting, and I'll turn it on. It's good entertainment. And I'll turn it on for a few minutes and listen to it. But if you begin to leave town, your signal gets weaker and weaker. If you're on 49, by the time you get to Flora, you can't pick up anything. Why is that? Well, because you've gotten further away from the signal. Which would lead me to say today, if you're a child of God and you're sure of that, but it's been a long time since you've heard from God, you've moved away from the signal. You've separated yourself from him. You have moved. God hasn't moved, but you have moved away from him. That relationship is not what it needs to be. And many times there's sin in the midst of that relationship. Sin is blocking that signal. And so what we must do is live a life, obviously, of repentance. See, a true Christian is going to be sensitive to the sin that's in their life. And it's going to lead them to genuine brokenness and confession. But the person who says they're a child of God and is not sensitive to sin, that their sin does not lead them to confession, that person is not saved. And you may say, well, man, you're being mean today. Take it up with God and his word. I'm sounding a warning to us today. That there's a lot of professing Christians in our world today who don't have a problem with sin in their life. And many of them, if not most of them, are going to burst the gates of hell wide open. because they don't have a problem with the sin in their life because they don't know the Savior. They don't have a problem with sin in their life because they haven't encountered the conviction of the Holy Spirit because God isn't speaking to them. And we're not his sheep. And today, you need to be saved if you want to hear from God, have any change in your life. See, I'll be honest with you. There's not a time I don't open up God's Word that God doesn't point out sin in my life. Every time, if I'm honest to sit still and to hear from God and read his Word, not just to check something off, but to seriously, intently study his Word, think about his Word, God is going to point out something in my life that needs to be adjusted. And I think that's true for every single one of us. And so if you can say that you can open God's Word, you can sit in here and you cannot be convicted, if you can sit in a Sunday school class and not be convicted, then I would say today you're not saved. And I challenge you today, I urge you to swallow pride and confess the Lord today and surrender your life to him. Once we do that, what else is required for us to hear from God? Because again, there's times when we're saved, there's a poor connection that's there, or time maybe we haven't heard from God, at least the second requirement. And that's that we must acknowledge the goodness of God. If we're honest, there are times that we don't want to hear from God because we're afraid of what he might make us do. So you would say many times we're just journeying through life. God comes, God speaks to us, and he adjusts life. He makes us uncomfortable. He makes us get rid of some sin. He may change a direction in our life. He may cause a career change. He may cause some relationships to end. Whatever the case is, that God is doing something and he disrupts our life. And we adjust to that, and we get over it, and we get back, we're on the path, and we're walking with him, but we don't want to go through that again. For sure not anytime soon. And so we just kind of coasting going, God, I really hope you don't disrupt my life today. God, I'm going to read your words, I can check it off, and I'm going to do it real quick because I don't want you to cause me any sacrifice. God, I'm going to go to worship, but I'm not really going to be in tune with you because I don't want you to disrupt my plans. And we live like that, whether we want to admit it or not. So we must acknowledge the goodness of God. And until we acknowledge that God is good and that his ways are good, we will not be able to hear from him and we will not be able to live a life of surrender. Jesus speaks about this when he talks about the two kind of shepherds in his day. One kind was to be a member of the household. So you're part of the family that owned the sheep. You might be a son, you might be a daughter, you may be considered a servant that was considered part of the family unit, and you knew of no other way than to raise sheep and to take care of sheep. David was an example of that in the Old Testament. He was a shepherd. It was the family business, the family line, and that's what David was to do. That's the first kind of shepherd here. But Jesus speaks of a shepherd who was the hired hand. His devotion to the sheep, to the welfare of the sheep, it was tempered by his own self-preservation. If something came to attack the sheep and he felt like he couldn't ward it off, then he would leave and let it have the sheep. He was there for the check. He wasn't there for the well-being of the sheep. And so Jesus points out how this guy would abandon the flock in order to protect himself, that this was a relationship of convenience. Verse 12, the hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, so he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and he runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and he cares nothing for the sheep. But Jesus is teaching the people and us today that he's the first kind of shepherd. The good shepherd, he says in verse 11, he's part of the household that owns the sheep. The good shepherd isn't taking care of the sheep for money. Rather, he's taking care of the sheep because they belong to the Father and to him. And he's telling us that he didn't take care of us because he's getting a check out of the deal. But he takes care of us because we belong to the Father and to him. That Jesus will not abandon us in the face of an enemy. He's not a hired hand. He stands with us, he fights for us, and he provides us safety. And we must acknowledge that he is good and his ways are good. And we must desire for him to speak to us, even if it means our life is going to be shaken. When Moses wanted to know God deeper, he pleaded with God, please show me your glory. He was asking God, show me who you really are. Let me get a better glimpse of you. And he knew he could not see the face of God and live. And so he wanted just to get a glimpse of him. Show me as much as I can stand, is essentially what he's saying. So what did God do? Exodus 33, 19 and 20 gives us God's response. Listen to it. I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before you. Moses wanted to see God's glory. And God showed him something so wonderful that it caused the skin of his face to show with the radiance of God's presence. And what did God show him? He showed him his goodness. You ever stop to think about that? That the face of Moses glowed because of the goodness of our God. There's not a single person in here today who has not experienced outrageous, lavish, unexpected, undeserved kindness. We call that grace. And we experience it every single day of our life. It's poured out over us constantly. And so I can declare with total confidence today that an unchanging truth that permeates every aspect of our society is that God is good. God is good. And we should desire to hear from him because of his goodness. Yeah, it may disrupt our life, but it will be because God is good. And it may cause us to sacrifice, but his ways are good. It may disrupt our plans, but his will is good. We must acknowledge the goodness of God if we want to hear from him. And thirdly, we must desire the satisfaction of God. John 10:10, I think, is one of those verses that we ought to stake our life on. Where Jesus tells us that the thief comes to kill, steal, and to destroy. But I have come so that you may have life and have it to the full, or have it in abundance. See, the thieves would sneak into the pens to steal the sheep or to kill the sheep. They were on a destructive path. The thieves that Jesus were speaking to about here were the Pharisees and the false teachers, the false prophets. But even the devil himself is referred to as a thief, looking to destroy us. And what the devil has to offer us looks fun. It looks satisfying. Remember, sin is fun for a season. But it'll always take us further than we wanted to go, make us pay more than we wanted to pay, and make us stay longer than we ever thought we'd have to stay. But it looks attractive. That's why the devil's so successful with his temptations. And so we find ourselves empty, searching for more, searching for meaning and for purpose in life, knowing that I've fallen for the trap, but it's not fulfilling, it's not satisfying. Instead, I'm hurt and I'm destroyed and my life seems to be wasting away. And Jesus comes to tell us there's more to life than living and dying. There's more to life than this cycle that we find ourselves going into, of falling into the traps of Satan. He has come so that we can have life to the full. Life in abundance. And listen to me, that doesn't mean just at death. For so long we talked about the abundant life that awaits us in heaven. And that is an abundant life that we can never fathom here on earth. And we should long for that. That ought to motivate us to live for the Lord, because we know that's the inheritance that we have with him. But that abundant life begins the moment we place our faith in Jesus Christ. That it's there that he transforms our life. And we realize that we were made for more than just that old cycle of falling into the devil's traps over and over again, that we can have deep satisfaction and fulfillment in life. And it's only available through Jesus. That every single day of our life, we can enjoy His victory over sin and death. And we can be satisfied. See, if we don't want to hear from God, if we don't hear from Him, we don't have the satisfaction. And so even though there's some times He's going to disrupt our life, there's going to be some things that we don't want to hear. If we want to have the abundant life that He expects us to have and that He died for us to have, then we must desire the satisfaction of God. Failure to thrive is a diagnosis given to children who do not grow the way he or she should, or they don't gain the weight that's needed. Sometimes it has something to do with an infant's metabolism. For reasons that nobody can understand, this child is just not gaining weight. They're not thriving. They even determine that a parent or a caregiver, if they're depressed, that depression can get passed down, so to speak, to the child, and that child does not thrive. He just senses that something is wrong. So it's failure to thrive. The word thrive is a life word. For thriving is what you and I were intended to do. It's like a flower that stubbornly pushes through the crack in the sidewalk. We are to be people who thrive. And until we live a life that hears from God regularly, we will not thrive. Failure to thrive will be said of us until we live a life that hears from God. And that hearing leads to obedience to Him. And then we understand the satisfaction of God. That we can look and know that we have life to the full. The abundant life that He died for us to have. Today, as you look at your life, your spiritual life, would you have to say, you know what, I'm suffering from a failure to thrive. I'm not putting on the spiritual weight. I'm not growing in my spiritual journey. I'm not thriving in my life. If we would wonder why, if we go back and look, it's because you're not hearing from God. You've moved far away from the signal. There's something blocking the signal in your life. So I'll bring us back to the grocery list. Standing at the aisle trying to figure out which toothpaste, which cereal, which shampoo, which milk, which orange juice to get. Today you find yourself there spiritually. Which way should I go? What's God's will? What do we do? The choices in our life is many. Today, do you hear the Lord? If not, are you saved? Or could it be that you're afraid to hear from Him because of how He may disrupt your life? And you can say, in all honesty, you know what? I've sat in Sunday school and I've sat and listened to a sermon and I haven't heard from God. And I would say that you're far away from God. You may never have known Him. Or there's something that's blocking that relationship. And those closest to you know it because you're not satisfied. You're longing for something more. Another relationship, more power, another position. The dirt on somebody. Whatever it is so that you can get satisfaction. And you haven't heard from Him. Today, we need to thrive. So our time of commitment, let us desire the satisfaction, the abundant life of God. Let's pray together. Holy God, You know us. You know us intimately. You know every hair on our head. You know every detail about us. You know about the things that kept us up at night that nobody else knows about. You know the things that are causing pain in our life today. You know about the things that aren't bringing satisfaction to our life. You know every detail, and yet you still love us. You're still good. And as a reminder of that goodness today, you've convicted us of sin. You've showed us what's required of us. For some, you may have asked for some very difficult things to happen in their life. But Lord, because of your goodness, let us walk in faith and obedience today. There are some here, Lord, who need to be saved. And maybe everyone else here thinks they've got a relationship with you, but they're going to burst the gates of hell wide open. I pray for your conviction to fall upon them. Let it fall upon each one of us till we can say that we are thriving, satisfied in you. Would you be pleased with our response to you during this time of commitment? It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand together? And as we sing, as altars open, Aaron, John, and I are here to receive you. Would you do what you need to do today so that you can leave here living a life thriving, hearing from God?
Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. Take your truth, plant it deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness, that the
What are you going to do today with how God has spoken to you? See, we're stewards of every opportunity that God has given us. Many times we think that if God speaks, we know what we should do, that if we'll just wait long enough, maybe the conviction will pass. What a horrible way to live our spiritual life. So maybe you were hoping for this invitation to end, but it hasn't. Maybe God's telling you, hey, it's still going for you. Will you be obedient? Will you leave here thriving today? Or are we going to still limp along? Can you leave here saying you're satisfied in the Lord? Or you find your satisfaction in something that's fleeting?
Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you do speak to us, and we fail so many times to listen. I pray that you would open our spiritual ears, that we might hear what you have to say to us, and after we hear it, that we will obey. Thank you for the way you've blessed us in so many ways, and we come now to return a portion of what you've blessed us with in monetary ways. We ask that we'd be generous and that you would bless this offering. In Jesus' name, amen.
As always, thank you for being here and making the choice to worship with us today. I want to encourage you to be back this evening at 5 o'clock. It's Awana for children, youth, small groups, and adults. We're going to meet in here to talk about your design. If you ever wonder where you fit in the church, what role do I have, I encourage you to be here tonight. We're going to talk about how God has designed you and how he's going to use your design. So I encourage you to be here again. We'll gather in here at 5 o'clock. Next Sunday is our kind of a big day for us. Next Sunday, we're going to celebrate 175 years of ministry as a church. And so you need to note, that we are starting at 10:45 next Sunday. What time are we starting?
10:45.
Somebody's going to forget that next week. And they're going to walk in about 11 or 5 till 11 and go, somebody's in my seat. And we're going to have a fight because somebody's going to be in your seat. So we're starting at 10:45. We're going to have a little longer service as we celebrate, talk about some things that happened over the last, a few things that happened over the last 175 years, but also as we look ahead. We'll be blessed to have Dr. Jim Futrell with us, who's the executive director of the Mississippi Baptist. He will be here to share with us that morning. We're having lunch afterwards, and hopefully you've signed up. If not, you might still can do that if you'll go do that before we turn it off, but you have to do that online. But hopefully you're planning to spend the day. I know we have several former members that are coming back, folks that grew up here that have been off. I noticed they've signed up for lunch. So it's going to be a great time together. So you'll want to be in Sunday school on time because you're going to have to finish a little early to be in here at 10:45. Now, that starts our revival services. So next Sunday at 5 o'clock, Dr. Futrell will be back with us. And then Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, Dr. Ted Traylor from Pensacola, Florida will be here. And you're going to love both of those guys. And also simultaneously with that, our children's revival will be going on. It will be a little different that we're going to start it Sunday morning this time. So our kids will be meeting sixth grade, K through six, will be meeting separately during that time, and they all have their own service every night as well. And so that's what we've been journeying together, this 40 days of focus to get ready for what God's going to do next Sunday. God's already doing some great things in life, and I look forward to seeing what he's going to continue to do. So be prayerful this week, reading your journal about hearing from God. Let's desire to hear from him and come here next week to celebrate, yes, the goodness of God over the last 175 years, but most importantly, for us to worship him and experience revival. Let's stand together. And it's because our chains are gone that we can be revived. Let's declare that as we go.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. See you.